Hello, in this video we are going to talk about 59 web technologies you should know. Basically from PHP to Python to C#, to Java, Android, Kotlin, Swift, and all these kind of technologies, also in the front end, back end. These technologies you should know about, and we are discussing this in this video. Hello, my name is Sascha Tatil. I'm the founder of softwaredeveloperindia.com. We're providing software developers from India to companies globally, mainly for agencies and web agencies and IT service providers from Europe mainly. And this video should help you to understand the basics of the different technologies. It's not giving a deep dive into all technologies, just a rough overview so that you know what you're dealing with. So if, for example, someone says, okay, Python, then you should know approximately what it is, Java, and so on. Let's dive into it. The first is PHP. PHP is it's not a programming language, it's a scripting language, but this technology is mainly used for building web applications, and I would say that you could build almost 99% of all web applications you see online, you could build with PHP, because PHP might not be as, doesn't have, not have a strong performance. So for example, if you have millions of users using the web application at the same time, it will crash. But how does the reality look like? In most applications which are used online are used only by a few hundred people a day, especially if it's a smaller application. And that is why PHP could be used in that case. Laravel is a popular PHP framework. In the last few years, it has become more popular, and it's possible to develop in PHP faster. For example, if you want to build like a form, or you want to build a web applications, then Laravel already has some built-in modules, which makes it faster to build PHP applications, and it's also called a PHP framework. Zend is another PHP framework. In the last few years, it has become less popular, mainly because Laravel has become more successful. But still, Zend is an enterprise-based PHP framework. That means especially medium-sized companies are using it to build web applications. So you will find, especially in Europe and maybe also in the USA, you will find medium-sized applications. Sometimes even large organizations use medium-sized applications in Zend. And Symfony is another enterprise PHP framework. But the thing about Symfony, it's, you could say, an alternative to Zend. So basically, you could either use Symfony or Zend if you build enterprise web applications. And if you build other applications, you could use Laravel. But nowadays, I would say that most people are using, for the new applications, they use Laravel. And in many old successful applications which were built many years back, they were mainly built in Symfony and Zend. That is why there are many opportunities still available in Symfony and Zend. Then the .NET. .NET is a Microsoft framework, and it's also used for medium-sized enterprise web applications. And it has many layers, so basically you could build desktop applications with the WPF or WinForms. You can build mobile applications, web applications with ASP.NET. You could use the programming language C#, which is a part of .NET, to build scalable solutions which are fast. And then you might wonder why you should use .NET instead of maybe, for example, PHP, which is also a good solution. But .NET is much more built for the enterprise. So basically, it is built for organizations which need secure solutions, which need to build web applications for their, for example, if they have a marketing department, to build some solutions for them, or for the sales department, or maybe for the HR department, they need to build solutions. So .NET framework is a good solution to build medium-sized applications, especially in the enterprise area. I mean, with enterprise, I mean large organizations or even medium-sized organizations. And as I mentioned, ASP.NET is the web framework of .NET. So basically, if you build a web application, you would build it with ASP.NET. And usually ASP.NET has the advantage, if you build a button or something, it can be almost like drag and drop, but still you need experienced developers to build really good solutions. And among this ASP.NET, there are even inside there are many frameworks, and ASP.NET MVC is the most popular ASP.NET web framework. So basically, if you build web applications, usually you use this MVC framework, but MVC just means that it is layered. So basically, there's some front-end part, there's some back-end part, and for a developer, it is easier to develop with this MVC framework. And C# is the programming language which is used by the .NET framework, and C# was developed by Microsoft, but nowadays C# has become really a enterprise programming language, and some use it as an alternative to Java, and it has become really popular, especially when medium-sized companies are building scalable and large enterprise systems. In Java, if you build a large application nowadays in the enterprise area, usually you will use Java. So basically, even though Java might be only 10% of the developers, but it has like 90% of the market, because a solution like Google or Amazon, or also the banking system, the financial institutions, large organizations, almost all these companies are using Java for development of their enterprise solutions. So basically their core solutions. So basically, for example, even if you want to fly a plane, maybe they will use Java to build these solutions. If you have a banking system, the main solution will be in Java. And like I said, Amazon and the other large organizations are using this technology. So Java is very important. But another thing about Java is you won't see it in small companies. Mainly, it is used by large companies. Python is also a scripting language, and this Python can be used, for example, if you have a lot of data all over the net and you want to gather it together. For example, Google would use such a solution, or other lot of web applications use it to, for example, there are many PDF files all over the internet and you need to pull them together and show them to some user, then you could use Python. So especially also large organizations are using Python to build really fast applications. Like Java, you won't find Python in smaller companies. It's mostly used by large applications. Then Ruby on Rails. Ruby on Rails was popular a long time ago. Ruby is the programming language, and Ruby on Rails is the web framework for Ruby on Rails, or for Ruby. And also with Ruby, you can do this crawling like in Python also. But nowadays, people would either use Python or they would use PHP to do the same tasks. And I would say that nowadays it's not that popular anymore, but you will still find Ruby on Rails developers and you also Ruby on Rails projects, because maybe 10 or 15 years back, many successful applications which are still running today built on Ruby on Rails, so you will find still opportunities in this area. But in my experience, it's a little bit tougher to find developers, because not many people are ready to learn this technology, because it is only used by older technologies, not in startups or in other newer enterprises. And C++, if you are learning programming, then usually if you go to university or some education place, they will usually teach you C++ or Java. So even now, if you go into, I would say it is not that popular anymore, but still it's very powerful. So if you want to build really scalable solutions, you can use C++. You won't find it that much anymore, but still, if you want to build really strong solutions, you can use C++. And Node.js is a JavaScript framework, so you can build web applications in the, so basically, if you have PHP, it's more like a backend programming language, but with Node.js, you can do the backend, the frontend, you can do so-called full stack development. And you might wonder, okay, why shouldn't I use PHP for building web applications? So basically, if you need really fast applications, right? You need a lot of users are accessing your application, and then you could use Node.js. The thing about Node.js, it might be a little bit difficult to understand the use case, because there are so many other technologies which I told before, like Python, PHP, .NET, Java, and so on. But still, there's some use cases where you could use Node.js to build applications. For example, Netflix and other technology companies are using Node.js to build their web applications. As I said, the advantage is that multiple users can access this solution, and it's still fast and scalable. Vue.js is a small and fast front-end JavaScript framework. So basically, if you build something, for example, in PHP or in Laravel, usually a lot of developers who use Laravel PHP framework, they will use Vue.js in the front-end, but Vue.js can be used in almost any front-end technology. And the advantage of Vue.js, it's smaller in size, so basically it's faster also when you build applications, and also when users use such applications, it's faster in loading. So a lot of developers use Vue.js because it's small and fast. And React.js, another front-end framework based on JavaScript. It was, as far as I know, made by either by Google or by Facebook. I think by Facebook. And now you wonder, okay, why you shouldn't use Vue.js and you should instead use React.js. React.js is much more elaborate. So basically, if you have more requirements, maybe you want to build also a mobile application, then you could use React Native. So it's based on React.js. So basically, you could just build the front-end web application in React.js. You could build a mobile application in React Native. So you have much, it's a bigger tool, and you can do much more with React. So it's a good use case. Angular is yet another JavaScript framework. So basically, it was made a few years back by Google, or one of the developers at Google that made this Angular.js, and it was one of the main front-end frameworks. And you could create so-called single-page application. So basically, what is a single-page web application? For example, usually, if you build a web application, whenever you click on the website, it will call, go to the server, and it will call again a new functionality. But in Angular, it calls everything at once, and then it will execute inside the web browser, and it's therefore much faster. And that's also why it's called a single page application, because it loads once in a single page and you can do a lot of stuff. But nowadays, I would say that it is shifting towards Vue.js and React.js. So less people are using Angular and more people are using Vue.js or React.js. So, and JavaScript or vanilla JavaScript, vanilla JavaScript or vanilla JS is basically the same as JavaScript. But basically what they're saying is you would only use JavaScript, right? So plain JavaScript is also called vanilla JavaScript. And some developers prefer to use JavaScript only because they're more flexible, right? So basically you could use in the backend PHP without a framework, and JavaScript in frontend without a framework. And you are more flexible to build web applications. So you would see a lot of web applications which are based on JavaScript only in the front end. And like I said, it is more flexible than if you would use a front end framework like Vue.js or the React.js. So you could build whatever you want. So WordPress, most of you already know WordPress. WordPress is a content management system. So basically, a lot of web agencies use it to build small websites, and it's very fast. So basically you can just click and install it. And I would say that almost all smaller websites are made in WordPress. So basically if someone decides, okay, I want a personal website, then they just download some themes. Maybe it costs $50 or something, and then you can download it and upload it to your own server or your web poster. A lot of plugins, a lot of themes, which make it easier to develop in WordPress. The only issue is that it's not that powerful. So basically, if you want to have like a very flexible website, large-scale website, then of course people are not using WordPress, then they would use other tools or other content management systems. And WooCommerce is a plugin which is used in WordPress, and this plugin makes you can make an online shop very easily. But I would say that you can only build very small shops with a few products. For example, you're selling smartphones, then maybe you can only have 10 to 100 smartphones, and maybe only have 10 to 100 users per day who are buying, or maybe up to 1,000 users per day who are buying via this online shop, because it cannot handle that much. But still, it's interesting if you want to enter into e-commerce quickly, then WooCommerce could be an option. And Magento is an enterprise shop system. So basically, I talked about WooCommerce, but WooCommerce is with very small shops. And if you have a larger shop, and you still want to have a lot of out-of-the-box functionalities, then you can use Magento for e-commerce. For example, if you have a shopping cart, you know, the shopping cart where you click and you can buy some stuff. In Magento, all these shopping carts are already there, so you click there and you can go into the payment process, and there are plugins where you can make payments. So Magento is very fast in development, but still you are very flexible. So basically, that is why also large organizations use it to build Magento online shops. So maybe it is not used by small companies, but to medium to large sized organizations who need some shops to sell their products. And you might wonder, okay, why they're not using Java to build like an Amazon shop? Because a lot of companies don't have their focus on e-commerce. Their focus is mainly building maybe a smartphone, building a camera, building a laptop like Dell. And they want to have an e-commerce shop also. And how they can do it without too much maintenance, they could use an online shop system like Magento. And a shopware is, you might not have heard about shopware, but in Europe or in Germany or in some European countries, shopware is used as an alternative to Magento. So basically, if you're in some small to medium sized company and you have a small to medium sized budget, then you could either choose between Magento or shopware. But shopware has the advantage that it's made for the European market, especially the middle countries like Germany, Switzerland, Austria, and so on, which have a certain taste in UI/UX and so on, and shopware could be a good solution for these countries when it comes to e-commerce. And we talked about WordPress. WordPress is used by smaller organizations or smaller companies or freelancers or web designers also and so on. But if you go into the enterprise, so basically medium-sized organizations or large organizations, and they want to implement a content management system, then you cannot rely on WordPress, because it will maybe, if too many users are using it, it might crash. So basically, like, you know, in your PC, if you use too many applications, it will become a blue screen like that. If too many people use it, it will become a white screen on a website, right? So you use a more scalable solution like Drupal. You're more flexible and you can build really large systems which can be used by many employees, for example, who want to use it as an intranet, for example, to get information, or where the manager can write a blog post, or they can write a blog post for their website. So in Drupal, you can also build a website, right? So, and for an organization. And Typo3 is also a content management system, but you will see it also in German language speaking countries, like, for example, Germany, Austria, Switzerland, and it's an alternative for Drupal. For example, I told you about Shopware, which is an alternative to Magento on a global scale, right? And the same thing is for Typo3. For example, if you have Drupal, is an enterprise content management system. The same way, Typo3 is also a enterprise content management system, and you could use it. You could either decide to use Drupal or Typo3. And I would say that Typo3 is becoming also more popular worldwide, but Drupal is already a global content management system solution. Contao is also a content management system, but it's very small, but very flexible. So basically, if you have a requirement for a very small content management system, where you need to only have a few information, where you need to create blog posts and so on, but you need to have it very flexible, right? Then maybe don't use WordPress, use Contao, and you can build small scalable solutions in Contao. Especially programmers like this tool. And I would say also that mainly it is used in Europe, so that is why you might not heard about Contao before. So what is mobile app development? So you might know what is mobile app development, but if you talk about mobile app development, it's like in your smartphone you have apps, right, which are based on Android or iOS. So if you have an Android phone, for example, you have apps which you download from the Google Play Store, and these applications are usually made with some programming languages like Objective-C or Kotlin, and it's also called native app development. That we'll discuss later. I just wanted to explain what are mobile apps. They are different, for example, also from web applications, which you can call from your browser. So, for example, in your smartphone, you will have a browser like Google Chrome or Mozilla. And if you open this website there, it is basically not an app, right? So, for example, you could open your website YouTube on your smartphone, but it's not the app. You could download the native app, right, from the Google Play Store, install it on your smartphone, and then you could use YouTube via the app. And what is the advantage of an app? It is much more faster. It can work, it can use the CPU, it can use the storage, it can use many things in which are used inside the smartphone, and that is why it is more performant, and you can do a lot of more things with a native app or a mobile app. So there's this mobile app development where you basically would build for Android or for iOS, but the problem there is you would need to build separate apps, right? You would need to have one developer who develops the Android app, you have one developer who creates the iOS app, you might need to have a web developer, a database developer, so many people you need, but small companies or a startup or the small organizations, they cannot afford to have so many developers, they cannot hire 4 or 5 developers to build an app. So for that, a new category of app development is created, which is called hybrid app development. So you only have one code base, you program once, and this solution builds applications which can be used on all platforms, right? It can be used on Android, iOS, maybe also web in the website. And the most common are one which I mentioned here, Flutter, PhoneGap, Xamarin, and React Native. Flutter is made by Google. They have created a programming language called Dart, and it's very performant, and many companies are using nowadays Flutter for app development or hybrid app development. For a long time, people used a PhoneGap because it is very easy to build, because a web developer can use HTML, CSS, JavaScript to build web or mobile applications. But the problem is it's not that performant. So basically, if you use PhoneGap app on Android or iOS, it will be usually not so fast, and you can see how it will load only very slowly. So that is why many people are going towards Flutter. Then Xamarin is mentioned here. So basically, it's based on .NET framework, which I have also explained in this video. .NET framework, many companies are already using the .NET framework, so they want to have they want to have a solution which can be easily integrated into their current systems, and they can use Xamarin. But also here I would say that many people are shifting from Xamarin to Flutter, because Flutter is more performant and people like to work with Flutter more. I don't know why exactly, but there's a shift towards Flutter and also a shift towards React Native. So basically, that's the React Native is basically, also main nowadays, hybrid app development mainly occurs in Flutter or React Native. React Native is maybe not as performant as Flutter, but if you build in React Native, it's easier to build, for example, the web solution also, which might not be possible in Flutter. And you might wonder, okay, if they can build a solution with one developer for all platforms, why should someone hire more developers to build native applications, right? So basically, like I told before, for example, a company like Google, why should they develop with Flutter? They could have separate developers for all these technologies. Like I said, if you build for Android, it will be faster, and if you build a native app for iOS, it will be also faster. So they will always decide for this apps which are native. So this native app development mainly occurs with Objective-C, that's a programming language which you could use for iOS apps. Swift is also for iOS apps. And if you want to build for Android, you use either Kotlin, which is the mobile app framework for Android, or you can use the programming language Java. So like I said, a large organization could easily afford to hire separate developers for all these technologies, because an Android developer cannot build an iOS app, an iOS app developer cannot build an Android app. So basically, they're so complex, these technologies, that they usually focus on one. So basically, you have an iOS developer, an Android developer, and for the other technologies, maybe for the website, you have a PHP developer, for the backend, you have a maybe a database developer. But still, large organizations will do it. But if it's smaller companies, usually they will prefer to have a hybrid app, because they can develop it once and use it everywhere. Another technology or a term which you will find is called full stack developer. So full stack developer basically means someone who can do everything from the front end development to the back end development to the database development. So basically the front end is usually made in HTML, CSS, JavaScript. The back end is made in PHP, Java, or any other technologies which I have mentioned till now. Or the data and the database is done in MySQL and MongoDB. But there's a reality. Usually people are very focused on their own technologies, right? Like a backend developer might not be able to do the front end, and the front end developer might not be able to do the back end. So basically what you usually do is you look for a back end developer and a separate front end developer. And the backend developer usually also does the MySQL, MongoDB programming. So at least you need two developers to build a web application. And this full stack developer term is, I would say, difficult to confirm, because a lot of people are looking for these people, but usually people tend to be in one area. So a full stack developer, there are many developers which call themselves full stack developers, but still, usually they are either a front-end developer or a back-end developer. Also, Python also has a framework which is called Django. There are also programmers who use this technology, but in this video I'm not going to talk much more about Django, but you should know there's a Python framework called Django. And there's another mobile app framework which is called Ionic. Ionic was also a little bit popular, like PhoneGap. It's also based on HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and you might also find this technology still, because a few years back when PhoneGap and Ionic were popular and there were not options like React Native or Flutter, which are very new, and at that time people would use PhoneGap or Ionic. And what is a front-end developer? So front-end developer are people who are using, for example, HTML, CSS, JavaScript. HTML, you might know, CSS is the is used to make it look more beautiful, this HTML. And JavaScript is basically, you can smaller functionalities in the front-end can be done with JavaScript. Today you would call a front-end developer usually UI UX developer, user interface or user experience developer. I think there's not much difference. The only difference is maybe that a UI UX developer will look to make much more modern user interfaces, and there are many books and many blog articles and websites where you can learn more about UI UX development. And what is a UI UX designer? So basically you have, like I said, the HTML, CSS, JavaScript or front-end developer or the UI UX developer. But the problem is you need to sometimes create it first in a wireframe or maybe on paper. And for that you need a designer, right? Someone who is creative, who can create the design, for example, in Photoshop or in Sketch. That's a new tool for building web applications. Basically only the design. So for example, you see this this site here in front of you, and that one is basically maybe made in Photoshop, and so then the Photoshop was created, the HTML CSS designer will then, or developer will then create an HTML CSS file out of this, which will be then given to the backend developer for integrating it into the website. So basically you have usually three people, right? So the UX UI designer or web designer who creates this thing on Photoshop or in a wireframe, then it goes to the UI UX developer who creates the HTML, CSS, JavaScript files, because it's a little bit complicated, because you need to create it for mobile, for desktop. It has to be responsive, right? It has to be becoming smaller and bigger according to the size of the device. And then the backend developer will create some backend functionalities, and then he will integrate the HTML, CSS, JavaScript files into the solution. So what is Bootstrap? Bootstrap is a front-end development framework which is based on HTML, CSS, JavaScript. So basically, a front-end developer, some companies want their developers to work faster, and you could use Bootstrap to do it faster because it already has a lot of things like responsive design is already included in this. So you could faster in development, the front end, right? So for example, if you build a website and you will be faster, then you can use Bootstrap. So the idea about frameworks is always to make something faster because it has out of the box tools or parts which you can use. Because for example, if you want to build a responsive design in HTML, CSS, JavaScript only without a framework, you need to be very experienced. But if you have Bootstrap, even a medium-sized or a junior developer would be able to build this front-end in Bootstrap. Zurb framework is another front-end framework based on HTML, CSS, JavaScript. It is not, I would say, it is not as popular as Bootstrap, but still a lot of companies are still using Zurb as an alternative to Bootstrap as a front-end framework. WinForms and WPF. So basically, if you want to build a Microsoft desktop application, so basically if you download some .exe file into your system and you execute it and some application will be loaded in your desktop system, then usually it is built on WinForms or WPF. Not always, but a lot of desktop applications are built with this technology. It's built on C#, and it's also part of the .NET framework. So basically, WinForms and WPF are for the desktop applications, and .NET or ASP.NET is for the ASP.NET is for the web framework, right? So for the websites and so on. And what is Salesforce? Salesforce is a cloud ERP system. So basically, inside a company, there are always many functionalities like the HR department, the sales department, the marketing department, the production team, and so on. There are many people, and they have usually some basic tasks, right? Like, for example, if you want to apply for leave, then you need to have some process. And usually these ERP systems are building these processes for applying for leave or for accounting and so on. And one popular tool is called Salesforce, and it is used by medium-sized to large organizations, and you can build it in the cloud. So cloud means that it is in hosted inside the website or in a server, and everyone can access it from remotely and or from their browser. And the advantage of such tools, there are many advantages actually, because then data will be not in silos, because that's a little bit a more difficult topic. Basically, before everything was on desktops or it was locally saved or maybe in a server inside the company. So the problem is there will be many data sets. For example, there will be one name. Maybe let's say Michael Thomas, he's called in that one, and in another system he's called Michael T. Now you have a problem: in one system he's called Michael Thomas, in another system he's called Michael T, and those systems don't know but that these two people are actually the same people. And with cloud ERP systems, you solve this silo issue. Basically, you have everything, you have one truth, so basically all information is saved in the same place, and you can easily have a good solution. SAP is basically what was before Salesforce, and even today many large organizations are using SAP, because, like, for example, if you are very large organizations with 50,000 employees or 100,000 employees or maybe 1 million employees, and you want them to access the leave system, you want to approve leaves, you want to make accounting, you want to do the billing and stuff, then you can use SAP. And the thing is, SAP is focused only, let's say, on the Fortune 500 or maybe, let's say, on the Fortune 5000, the biggest companies in the world, from usually with companies which have more than 10,000 employees usually. They use this tool for building large-scale solutions, and for this, usually SAP consultants or SAP developers are needed. And SAP is also building nowadays cloud solutions, but Salesforce was a little bit faster. Basically, Salesforce is the same thing as SAP, but Salesforce is in the cloud, which can be accessed to the web browser, and SAP is basically on your system or on your desktop, but this is also slowly changing. Then you have Microsoft Navision. Microsoft Navision is an ERP system for medium-sized companies, right? So not for very small companies, but for medium-sized companies, maybe 500 employees up to 5,000 employees. And for example, if you're manufacturing something, then a lot of companies are using it to do their basic processes, like, right, billing. For example, they sell one product, and now the product team wants to bill it, and then the billing team sends a bill. And Microsoft Navision can do this, and that is why it is very also popular in medium-sized companies. Like I said, SAP is very large for very large organizations, and Microsoft Navision can be used for medium-sized organizations. Then you have Odoo. Odoo is also used by, it's also an ERP system. It is used by small to medium-sized organizations, for example, and it is also cloud-based, right? So basically, like I said, Salesforce is for large organizations, and Odoo can be used by medium-sized organizations. So basically, it's an alternative, let's say, for Microsoft Navision, but I would say that Odoo can also be used by smaller organizations up to medium-sized, but I would say it is used by maybe if a company has 50 employees to 500 employees, right? Then it's used for companies of that size, or maybe up to 1,000 employees. Odoo would be used, and like I said, the advantage is that it's cloud-based, and you could basically access it from everywhere, right? You could have it via the web browser, and it's also very flexible, so it has many advantages, and more companies are using Odoo. Umbraco is yet another ERP framework or ERP system, but this framework is used in medium-sized companies, and it's .NET based. So basically, if a company already has .NET installed in their systems, like I said, in very large organizations, .NET is used. Also in medium-sized organizations, then they could use this Umbraco because it's already based on .NET. So a lot of companies are preferring Umbraco because other technologies like Odoo is, for example, based on Python. Salesforce, I don't know exactly which technology is used. SAP is based on ABAP, which is another programming language. So Umbraco, if some companies use .NET in their company, then Umbraco could be a solution. And as far as I know, mostly it is used in Europe. And then there are some smaller PHP frameworks. In the past, a lot of people used CakePHP, CodeIgniter, YII. That is why you will hear about this framework sometimes. But usually CakePHP and CodeIgniter are used for smaller, very small PHP applications. And also old applications sometimes run in this, but usually people tend to go to Send, Symfony, Laravel. So they're shifting this CodeIgniter solutions towards this newer PHP frameworks. But if you build a very small PHP framework, maybe or PHP or web application, then maybe this CakePHP, CodeIgniter, or YIA could be still used, but it is not used that much anymore. And Golang is a programming language created by Google, and you might find also some people who use this technology to build web applications, but not that many. But still, you should keep it in mind that there's a technology called Go or Golang. And then there's also something called software testing. So basically, if you build a web application or a software, then it needs to be tested because there could be many bugs, right? Maybe you click on a button and nothing happens, or maybe you click on a button and the wrong thing happens. So basically, a software tester could find out what this where the issue is, and they create a report maybe, or they point out to the developer, okay, here's an issue, you need to solve it. So this was already all the technologies, or the main technologies you should know that when you go, when you're in the software development or web development field, or you read some articles or something and you want to understand the basics, then this, I hope this video has helped you. And subscribe to this channel. There are always some new information about web technologies and similar videos, which is helpful to understand this field better. Thank you and see you soon.